ions. So, I mean, I just want to motivate you and just want you guys to pursue research in the area of ultrafast sciences. So that's why I have this little bit made it more fancier. Okay, but it is fancier. I mean, it's really a good and curious science to do that. But it, I will not say that if, only my science is better, but everything is better. But this is really a beautiful science we are doing in IIT Hyderabad, along with in collaboration with TIFR Hyderabad. So everything done in Hyderabad. So we are trying to, so we build an ultra fast camera which can actually image the atoms in it. So we have been doing this for small molecules, for simple molecules, the cheaper molecules, the things which are the molecules which exist in nature. So before I start, I will just first tell you that where are we located. So we are located in a small village in Kandi. It's again in Hyderabad, it's part of Hyderabad, but it's almost the outskirts of Hyderabad. So this is the most modern hostel you have ever seen. This is the coolest hostel which can remain cool in really the hot summer. So they have built a capillary inside, or the small tube inside, which can actually make the rooms really colder in summer. And this is the main academic block. This was the first block which came up when we moved to IIT, to the main campus. Earlier we were situated in old ordnance factory estate, but yeah, now we moved to permanent campus. So our lab, my lab actually is in two parts. One, a part of the lab is in TIFR Hyderabad, a part of it is in IIT Hyderabad. And so the things which we have been doing, we are building most of the stuff in-house. And and also we are doing this for others as well, for friends as well. So this, I'm setting up a fast camera in IIT Chennai. And yeah, so this is women empowerment. So see, these two guys are standing and taking picture. Huh? Okay, so this is is the first camera which we built in IIT, and this is again the first one which of its own kind in India as well. Okay, so and this is the student associated with it, with this program. So apart from building stuff, we are also involved in the beam time experiments. We keep going to Elettra, which is located in Trieste, Italy, the heart of Trieste. And so there they generate X-ray light, and then we just look at the different aspect of molecules. We are atomic and molecular physicists, so we just look at different aspects of atoms and molecules. Other than that, we also, just the atoms and molecule, we also have moved into the nanoparticles. So this is a part of this setup we have built for to look into the dynamics of nanotips. And since we are doing nanotips, so we have also have generated nanoparticles. And since these nanoparticles are heavier, my chambers are, the interaction chambers are quite far away. So I have to carry them in vacuum for a longer distance, so that they cannot just go down in the gravity, and when gravity is really the strong, I mean, it generally attracts all the heavier particles. So we have to carry it in the interaction region, and that is what we have made the aerodynamic lens, which can actually carry it for longer distances. So far, it's not longer distance as per se that for meters and meters, but maybe in future, who knows, we can actually carry it for meters and meters away. But this is almost, I mean, we can carry it for a meter away. So this we have built again in-house in IIT. And other than that, we are also fabricating some medical devices in IIT, and handheld mass spectrometer, or the micro mass spectrometer, we have been trying to build. And also some non-invasive devices like the glucometer and all. So there are that's the reason why I told that I'm working in two parts. One, in IIT, most of the stuff which we are using is the technology development, and in TIFR, what we are doing is what is our forte. So the most of the times the fundamental studies. Yeah, so what is today's talk about? So we will try to see the things which we cannot see, the atoms. We are surrounded by atoms and molecules. And this is what we want to do. So before that, let me just start with what we can see. So when, so this is the picture taken by ultra-fast camera. So you can see that the bullet is passing by, and then the drop which comes out, and then it just again it goes back, and then again the water when the drop goes up, then there is a there is a hilltop which is made on the in the water. So the bullet goes and then breaks this hilltop. And this was the picture taken by the ultra-fast photography. If that would not have been the case, it would have been more of an average picture, and you see some hazy picture out there. So something like this one. So generally, horse runs at the speed of roughly about 20 meters in a second. So this is 20 to 25 meters in a second, or roughly about 80 to 85 kilometer per hour. So it's nearly the alto speed which we take, which the alto can go up to, the maximum speed. So when we try to take the picture with the camera, not really the fast camera, this is how the legs will appear for a horse. So, but if let's say your camera is fast enough, so fast enough means there are two ways you can make. So you make a shutter speed, there is a camera shutter, so you might be click click sound that comes, and there is a something opening and shutting comes up, right, the sound. So that is basically the adjustment of the shutter speed, or you can say the exposure time. So let's say in the dark, if I try to take one picture, if I throw the ball and I want to take the picture, I will just take, I make a light which can pulse at really the high speed, and you can actually see the ball freezing. Okay, so your eyes eventually can see the ball freezing if you have a pulsating light source, which we call it as a stroboscope. So the same thing happens for this one, for ultrafast camera as well. You just generate a short exposure time, and then you just take continuous pictures and then make a movie out of it. And you see that at many times the horse feet were above the ground. So this is the beauty of ultrafast imaging. So this is when when the horse is running at the speed of 22 meters per second. Okay. You go even smaller, 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 that is where your atoms are. So the electrons, so the vibrational speed of the atoms in the molecule is something about femtosecond. You divide a second into 10 power of 15, and then that fraction is called 10 power of minus of 15 second. Okay, so then, I mean, this is really, really fast. So can you build such camera which can actually, where you can actually see the atoms going away from each other? Okay, so such camera, so that can, how can you actually make it possible? So there are cameras, so there you just, so you need a certain light source, which can actually, as I told, that is a stroboscope, and then that can generate a pulse of the order of femtosecond. 10 power of minus of 15 second. Okay, then you can actually see the atom that time, the vibration frozen at that particular time, and then you turn off the light, again you generate the light, again turn off the light, generate the light, and this you keep on doing, and then you can make movie out of it. And I mean, if you average them, if you just make a movie, so you can see that how the it is an atom as so the atom actually is moving from here to here, so you can actually see that, so you can actually picture that. So I mean to say that the idea is pretty simple, but I mean there are many challenges to it, and these are the challenges listed here. So first, you have to create the ultra short shutter time or ultra short exposure. So with the development of laser nowadays, it started somewhere in after 1960 from Ruby laser. Now we are in somewhere in 2020, so it is, the graph was available for 100 to 2010, but yeah, so now still we are making many developments. So the you can see the exposure, so shutter time you can actually generate up to at a second. So you can essentially image the electron as well moving around the nucleus, to, so to say. So the speed of that electron around the nucleus is something about 10 power of 6 meter per second. So in a second, it moves about 10 power of 6 kilometers, 6 meters. Okay, so that is, so that you can essentially image it. So that can be possible if you can generate really the ultra fast pulse light source. Okay, you have generated that. So now you so depending on what aspect you want to see, you can use that particular light source. It can be X-ray, it can be IR. So with that you can see, you if you want to just image atoms, you use IR or a bigger wavelength. But if you want to see the electron, you use X-ray. So because the X-rays can excite the electrons. Now, you have generated that, then the question comes: how will you image it? You need a camera which can actually record it, and that is generally that was somewhere the first camera which was built. It was in somewhere in 1992. That is that we call it as the 3D coincidence momentum imaging. So it actually records the momentum, whatever charged particles are generated, whatever particles are generated, you record all the direction momentum, x, y, z momentum. Once you, if you record x, y, z momentum, you have everything in your hand. You record, so you can actually, the momentum is recorded, you can calculate energy, you can see and you apply the conservation laws and all, and you can actually get all the information you want to generate when it was born. So that is again frontier of the technology, and you can, as I said, you can generate all the information. So combining the ultra short timing and combining this, you can get a complete set and which can actually look into the atom, into the molecule. Okay, so this is just one example here, which was in 2015, a group in Japan, they tried to image nitrogen molecule, and they just used radiation which can actually ionize it, and it really the ionization, it ripped off two or three electrons, and then essentially the nitrogen, there are two nitrogen ions again attached to each other, but while they are ionized, they are rotating. Okay, so in the field, so they have recorded that. So you see that this is what the laser polarization is, and this is, you see that at the molecule actually is rotating. So this here, this is the, you see these are the ions which are moving in there. So it's rotating, this molecular ion actually is rotating there. So this one is another picture which, so this, it's a unidirectional motion, so it will keep on moving. It's in a loop, so it will keep running. Okay, so now how will you generate the ultra short pulse? The idea is simple, that you can generate it, but how will you generate it? So for generation of the light ultra short pulses, Gerard and Donna were awarded the Nobel Prize in 2018. So they were the mind behind it. So to generate, just one line, this I always like it. Ultra short pulses are the shortest event ever created, and these are the guys again. So how will you generate it? The idea is again very simple. So let's say to understand that you generally we understand that there are two frequencies, they generally don't interfere. But idea is, if you have the two frequencies which are very close to each other, so they generate beam signal. You have done this experiment in 12th class, tuning fork experiment. So you have have one reference and the other one is the signal one, and you just try to oscillate the other one, so there will be beat signal generated. Okay, and the beats, it is nothing but just a constructive and destructive interference. Okay, so here those guys are destructively interfering, here they are constructively interfering, and you see the intense peak here. So it is starts to build up and then it maximizes, then goes down, maximizes, then goes down, and then maximizes. So if you keep doing that, our idea, our main aim is to make it more shorter and shorter in time. This is little broader, but I want little more shorter and shorter. So how can I do that? The idea is you again add many frequencies close together. So more the frequencies, better, the shorter this will be. So this is for the case of the tuning fork, and even the light waves also can actually interfere in a similar way. So they can, you sum the two frequencies up, and this is what you get. And if you keep adding, more and more frequencies, and where they maximize, so you basically phase lock them. So they all in phase will, you get a spike of a pulse and then nothing. Then a spike of a pulse and nothing. So these spike of pulse, they are actually well separated in time, and they are equispaced in time. And yeah, so this is how the pulses were generated. And later on, once you generate the pulse, you can amplify them. And this is what they were awarded the Nobel Prize for. So once, so what do we do here in IIT Hyderabad? We don't generate the light source. So the light, so now the system is commercially available. The laser system is available. So there are various companies around the world, those who are making ultrashort pulses. So in IIT Hyderabad, we try to make the camera. So this camera is a 3D ion imaging spectrometer. So here, either you can do ion imaging or you can do electron imaging. You cannot do both, but yeah, but then we have made one camera where you can actually image both. So here, this we called as the velocity map imaging spectrometer. So this spectrometer consists of three different electrodes. One, we call it as the pusher. Then it is a puller, and then, as the name suggests, pusher pushes the ion, puller pulls the ion, and there is a lens which actually lenses the charged particle on the detector over here. Okay, so if you see there, so charges, photons are there. Okay, so all around photons are there, photons will ionize. So it's a trail of photons, ions formed there. But and those ions can be of same energy. And I want all the same energy ions to focus right on at one place. So for that, we have simulated the trajectory of the ion. So here you can see there is the region where the ions are extended are almost for 5 mm. So 5 mm up and then 5 mm. So it's almost 1 centimeter broad charged particle source. And we applied voltages on pusher, puller, and lens in such a way that they go and focus on the detector. So generally, this we call it as a BMI spectrometer. So you can imagine it as that you are trying to image onion. Okay, if I try to take the photograph of onion, so I will not be able to see the rings inside that, right? What I see is the outside of that one. But I want to see the rings inside that. So what should I do? What I will be doing is, generally there are mathematical tools. We call it as the Abel inversion. And with that mathematical tool, imagine that there are different rings. In the middle ring carries lower energy, the outer ring carries higher energy, and the further outermost carries higher energy. You can imagine this is a 3D ball having a different energy of electrons on that sphere. Okay, so now what it does, this Abel inversion does, it just tries to bring all the ions on one line and then plots it in a 2D. So this is a slice of it, and you can actually image that. But what we have done, so these particles, all these particles are in the sphere. What I will be doing, I will choose only these ions which are right at the center. Okay, I slice them and I can actually image them. That is what I call it as the time slicing. So I will come to that later. So the thing is, the beauty of the spectrometer which we built is the calibration. So you have calculated, you know that there are different energy ions. Okay, the lower ones will go and hit the center of the detector. The higher energy ones will go and hit the outer part of the detector. So theoretically or mathematically, we can calculate the energy. So that energy energy of the particles will be depending on the radius, or the radius where they hit will depend on what energy of the particles are. Okay, so this is fine, but is it true? What I am doing is right or not? Wrong? Being a physicist, I should always question myself. So then what we did, so because we did not have multiple energy photons, so generally conventionally people have been doing what they do, they take an atom and they try to ionize, the electron comes out. If you keep changing, just remember the photoelectric effect, if you keep varying the frequency, your electron and kinetic energy will keep on changing, right? So starting from zero, you can actually go up to 10 eV. And every energy of the electron will hit at the different radius. Now because you know photon energy, and you also know the atomic source, and you know what is the energy potential of the atom, you know, and then you know what is the kinetic energy. So you know the kinetic energy, you know what is the radius it is hitting, you can actually calculate. But we did not have such source. What we had is the 800 nanometer light source, which the energy of it is 1.5 eV. We cannot change the angle. We cannot have multiple energy sources. So for that, and that this 1.4 cannot ionize it if you operate it in a low intensity. So for that, what we did, we operated this in a different mode. Okay, so there are two different modes which you can operate the spectrometer in. So one is when polarization, the light polarization, or the direction of the electric field of the light is perpendicular to the spectrometer. This we call it as the spectrometer mode, or the velocity mode, velocity imaging mode. The other one is the time of flight mode, where you rotate the direction of your light and let it follow the axis of the spectrometer and hit the detector. Okay, and now you just, for this one, all the equation of motions are all, since decades it had been derived. So for this one, I know what is the energy of the ions you are getting. Now compare with this one, you have everything in your hand, you have calibrated everything. So this is what, so this one is with the horizontal polarization, my energies are exactly matching with my vertical polarization. I have, so this means my spectrometer is really working fine, and all energies I am getting are with the calculation are actually right. Okay, so this we did with the different molecule, and this one is for the Coulomb explosion channel. I'll not go into the detail of that. Just take that there is one channel where the charged particles just repel each other, and they have very high energy. So that is that we call it as the Coulomb explosion channel. So this one exactly matches. So there are two different peaks, but we looked into the high energy peak, and high energy peak exactly matches in the two modes. One is the time of flight mode, where the polarization axis, the electric field of the light is along the axis of the spectrometer, and in another one it is perpendicular to the spectrometer axis. So yeah, so then this was the innovation in this spectrometer. And the other one is people have been using a mathematical tool. As I said, they trying to wrap up and then trying to find out the rings of the onion. I don't want to do that. What I did, so this is the time of flight. What I will do, if my whole onion is there, why can't I just slice this from the middle and I can image the onion? Okay, so this is what. So similar way we did it. We just took the middle slice and I imaged my onion, my energies of the ions. And you see there are various rings over there. These are the rings for the different energy of the ions which you are capturing. Okay. So this is the time slicing. I call it as a time slicing camera. So now we are ready. We have light source, ultra short light source. We have the spectrometer. Now what can we do? Now let's do the photo shoot of the ions. Now, so you have this molecule, and you expose it for the ultra short time duration, and then you start recording your spectrometer. So the experimental parameters are. We have almost 30 microjoule of photon energy. The pulse duration, which I said, the shutter speed you can turn on, turn off for 25 femtosecond. This is what is the 25 femtosecond pulse duration, and the wavelength of the light is 800 nanometer. Okay, so this 800 nanometer light, you can actually focus that, so intensity can become huge. However, the energy of one photon, if you see, it's 1.5 eV. So when the intensity is that much huge, your electric field around the nucleus, electric field which is generated will be something like 10 power of 7 volts per centimeter. To realize that, if you just keep two electrodes apart, two electrodes separated by 1 centimeter, so if one is at ground, the other one is 10 power of 7 volts, which you cannot generate in the lab. It is not possible. So if you cannot have such voltage source. So we depend on light. So light is really amazing. So you can generate, so light, if you focus it, this is the kind of electric field you can generate. Okay, and then that interacts with the atom, and it starts playing with the nucleus and the electron, and then it just tunnels out the electron. Electron just follows and falls in love with the light, and then it follows that. Okay, and sometimes it visits the its own parent, sometimes it doesn't, and light can take it away from the ion core. So yeah, so just I don't want to be deviated. Yeah, so our aim is to image the molecule. So we have done this experiment at 800 nanometer. So here this is what we got the image of, and this is what is the energy of all the rings corresponding to that. So there are two beautiful rings. So one is over there, and the other the smaller one. So this corresponds to the smaller kinetic energy. This peak corresponds to the outer one. So in outermost, you see there are four different lobes. They correspond to the orbital from where the electron had come out. Okay, and then the information also is translated to the ion, and this is what you see is the ion distribution. So you see the four beautiful lobes over there, and this distribution, what we see actually, this particular lobe, if you change the electric field, as I said, if you keep on changing the intensity, the light intensity corresponds to the electric field. Okay, if let's say there is a dipole, if you apply an electric field, it will start to deviate, right? So what I am doing, this is what exactly I want to do. So I have created this dipole, I have ionized it. The moment I ionize it, I made it a dipole, and now my electric field is there to play around with this dipole. Okay, now what I will, so I will just skip this slide, just, okay. So here, if I change the intensity, this is the intensity. So this is, so when I, so generally the oxygen, this is for the case of oxygen molecule can get ionized most when it is 40 degrees with the polarization. Okay, now if I start applying the electric field, increase the electric field, this molecule, this ion will start rotating, and this is what we see. See, this is at the lower field, this is at high, and this is further high. So it is getting rotated. This is what is happening for the molecule at 800 nanometer. So when we change the wavelength, so we just doubled the frequency, we change the wavelength, what we see, the molecule is not rotating. So here we did with at different light intensities, so the field is different, but this molecule is not rotating at all. So we try to, so this actually can be explained by, so what we have proposed, a model where we say that with a 800 or a 400 nanometer, we can actually go to certain levels. So certain, we can excite certain energy levels in the molecular ion, and that particular molecular ion have a different polarizability. So this polarizer, so the dipole can get aligned or anti-aligned in the electric field. So if the polarizability is positive, it will just follow the electric field. Okay, in this way. So this is, so if the polarizability is positive, it will just follow the electric field. However, if if you have negative polarizability, the molecule will not be able to get aligned. It will just go opposite to the electric field, and that is what we call it as the frustrated alignment. So basically, the light. So generally, what is happening for a certain time? What we are doing? Well, we are actually exciting it to go, bringing the molecular ion to a certain level, which has a transient negative polarizability. For a shorter, transient means it just stays for a small time, and this polarizability stays for certain time, and then for that particular time the molecule tries to anti-align, our electric field tries to align it. Okay, so this guy wants to go that way, this guy is trying to push it that way, so that way they both get balanced, and then you have it almost frozen. Okay, so at 400 nanometer we have developed theoretical model, and it actually fits well, and we call this as that transient negative polarizability, actually frustrates the alignment. So as a summary, so we study the molecular ionization and dissociation. What about that? So generally what we have developed the camera, or we can say the instrumentation in-house, and we try to see that the molecular ions are getting aligned or not. So depending on that, so at not all the wavelengths are able to align the molecule. So at certain wavelength actually it is not getting aligned. So the experimental observation actually are in line with our proposed theoretical model. So with this, I would like to thank you all for your attention, and I would also like to thank all my colleagues, and especially Arnab. I mean, he has been really a good student and have been doing most of the work analyzing the data, and we have submitted the paper almost. And yeah, I want to thank Professor Krishnamurthy for giving us the beam time for his laser system, and want to thank Bhas Bapat for giving me students. These two are the really, really the good students, and my collaborator and my husband too, Ram Gopal. So he is in TIFR. He has been a big help in TIFR. And my other students in IIT Hyderabad. And other than that, I would like to thank the funding agencies, DAA, DST, and MHRD. And with this, I would like to again thank you all for your attention. If you have questions.